Galen Marek was born on the Wookiee home planet of Kashyyyk at least 19 years before the Battle of Yavin, and was the son of Kento and Mali Marek, who were two Jedi Knights that managed to survive Order 66. Shortly after the death of his mother, Kashyyyk would be attacked by the Imperial military under the command of Darth Vader, who was hunting Jedi. Kento Marek would engage Vader, but would be defeated, and before dying, Darth Vader would discover that he had a son. Sensing Galen's powerful connection to the Force, Darth Vader would take Galen Marek and train him as a secret apprentice, giving him the codename Starkiller. For many years, Galen Marek would train under Vader, learning the ways of the Sith, but due to the rule of two, he could never be granted the title of Darth so long as Vader's own master, Darth Sidious, was still alive. Because of this, Galen was determined to grow stronger in the power of the ways of the Force in order so he could team up with Darth Vader, and together the two could defeat Darth Sidious. However, he only needed the opportunity to prove it. He would be given this chance when he was ordered to hunt down and defeat a few Jedi that had survived the Purge. Galen would defeat Jedi Masters Rom Koda on a TIE Fighter Factory, Kasdan Paradis on Raxus Prime, and Shaak Ti on Felucia. After defeating Shaak Ti, Galen would return to Vader, believing that he would finally team up with Vader to challenge the Emperor, only to be stabbed in the back once it was revealed that the Emperor had known about Galen the entire time. Galen would be thrown into the vacuum of space by Vader to show his loyalty to the Emperor. However, Galen's body would be recovered by Vader, and over the next 6 months was rebuilt, with Vader claiming that he needed to show the Emperor that he was dead, so that Galen could create a rebellion to distract the Emperor so that the moment of opportunity to overthrow him could be presented. After rescuing his pilot Juno Eclipse, Galen would eventually make his way to the planet of Bespin, where Master Rome Cutter was located after being blinded by Galen and surviving their duel. Galen wanted Koda's help to build a rebellion, and after escaping Bespin, would be directed to travel to the planet of Kashyyyk. While exploring the planet, he would not only experience some of his lost memories, but he would go on to rescue Princess Leia Organa and the local Wookiee population. After returning to his ship, Koda revealed that Galen had just saved the daughter of the Imperial Senator Bail Organa, who was seeking Master Shaak Ti on Felucia, but Galen did not reveal that Shaak Ti had already died. Once Galen had returned to Felucia, he saw that not only had the planet been completely fallen to the dark side of the Force, but that it was now being occupied by Imperial forces. Galen would fight his way through the Imperial forces and defeat the fallen Padawan of Shaak Ti, Mara's brood, and in doing so was successful in rescuing Senator Organa. Senator Organa was more than ready to help Galen build him a rebellion, but in order to convince the other senators that the Empire was indeed vulnerable, they needed to attack a significant target. After returning to Raxus Prime and destroying an Imperial shipyard, Galen, Koda, and the other senators would meet on the planet of Corellia and form the beginning stages of the rebellion, but they would suddenly be attacked by the Imperial forces and Darth Vader, who would go on to attack Galen, revealing that his entire mission was nothing but a ploy to trick Galen into gathering all of the Empire's enemies so that he could capture all of them at once. Just before Vader was about to finish off Galen, his friend Proxy would sacrifice himself, now taking on the form of Obi-Wan Kenobi, and would distract Vader, allowing Galen to escape. Being fed up with Vader's lies, Galen would reject his codename Starkiller and would recognize himself as a Jedi. Now as a Jedi, Galen would use the Force to see visions of the future, and this allowed him to discover the location of the incomplete Death Star. Galen would fight his way to the observation dome where Vader was waiting for him, and after an intense battle, Galen would be successful in defeating Vader and seriously injuring him. It was at this moment that the Emperor offered to take Galen as his new apprentice. Rom Koda would immediately attack the Emperor, but would be hit by Force Lightning. Galen would block the Emperor's attack and help contain the energy, allowing Koda and the other senators to escape. Unfortunately, Galen was caught in an enormous shockwave of energy, killing him. But though Galen had died, his death inspired the rebels to challenge the Empire and would use the Marek family crest as their symbol. Cal Kestis, like all Jedi, was recruited into the Jedi Order for being Force sensitive at a young age, and was the apprentice to Jedi Master Jarrow T'Pol during the Clone Wars. Cal and Jarrow were stationed over the planet of Bracca when Order 66 was activated, and while Cal managed to survive the attack, Jarrow was unfortunately hit by blaster fire, passing his now broken lightsaber to Cal. Over the next 5 years, Cal would stay in hiding while the Jedi were being hunted, and he would eventually find himself on Bracca working in the Scrapper's Guild as a rigger. After saving one of his friends with the Force, he was discovered by a pair of Imperial Inquisitors, forcing Cal to escape the planet. He would be rescued by former Jedi Shir Dunda and the pilot Grease, and taken to the planet of Burgano, where he would not only meet the tiny droid BD-1, but he would discover that Jedi Master Inno Cordova had placed a Jedi holocron containing the names and locations of Force-sensitive children that could be recruited to rebuild the Jedi Order. But in order to gain access to the holocron, Cal would have to travel to multiple planets finding clues that would allow him to open the vault on Burgano. Cal would then explore multiple tombs on the planet of Zepho. He would assist the Resistance and Wookiees in their fight against the Empire on the planet of Kashyyyk, and he would even travel to Dathomir, where he would not only meet the fallen Jedi Taro Malakos, but the last of the Night Sisters named Meran. Upon returning to Kashyyyk, Cal would then discover that the Resistance there had been nearly wiped out by the Second Sister and her forces, and upon speaking with the Wookiee chieftain Tarful, he would be directed to climb up what was called the Origin Tree, and upon climbing it, he would see another holo message from Cordova, who discovered that the special key for Regano's vault was located on Dathomir. Cal would then be immediately attacked by the Ninth Sister, and the two would engage each other in a fierce battle on top of the Origin Tree, but Cal would go on to not only cut off the Ninth Sister's hand, but was successful in outmaneuvering and force pushing her off the tree, defeating her, which allowed Cal to return to the Mantis and travel back to Dathomir. During his second trip to Dathomir, Cal and BD-1 would travel deeper into the tombs, where Cal would face Meran again, who would now summon the undead Night Sisters to slow him down. It was also during this trip that Cal would battle the giant creature named Gungora, who would fly around the tombs of Dathomir, but would eventually be defeated by Cal. Upon entering even deeper into the tombs, Cal would start experiencing flashbacks to Master Jaro's death as he tried to protect Cal from the clone troopers, but these flashbacks would cause Jaro's lightsaber to be destroyed. Without his weapon, Cal retreated back to the Mantis, where it was here that Shir would state that Cal needed to build a new lightsaber, and he would give Cal her lightsaber hilt to do so. The group would travel to the planet of Ilium, where all Jedi would go to retrieve their kyber crystals to build their lightsabers. After attempting and failing to build his lightsaber, BD-1 would show Cal the last message that he had saved from Master Cordova. This would inspire Cal to attempt to build his new lightsaber, this time combining the lightsabers of Jaro and Seer, and this time he would succeed in constructing a new lightsaber just for him. Now equipped with his new lightsaber, Cal would return to Dathomir one last time, and this time he would not only overcome his guilt that he felt over Jaro's death, promising to never forget his teachings, but he would then team up with Meran to defeat the fallen Jedi Taran Malakos, which allowed Cal to recover the Astrium, which would allow him to open the vault on Burgano. Upon recovering the holocron and seeing visions of a possible future where he would fail to protect the next generation of Jedi, Cal would battle Trilla the Second Sister, and though he would succeed in disarming her of her lightsaber, Cal would see a force echo revealing the tortures that Seer and her apprentice Trilla had been through, which allowed her to escape with the holocron. Upon returning to the Mantis, it was decided that the team needed to travel to the Fortress Inquisitor on Nur, and it was also time that Shir would reach out with the force, picking up Trilla's lightsaber, and would knight Cal as a Jedi. Cal and Shir would fight their way through the fortress, where Cal would battle Trilla one last time, defeating her and recovering the holocron. It was then immediately after this that Darth Vader himself would reveal himself, and after killing Trilla, he would force Cal and Shir to escape from the fortress. Once back on the Mantis, Cal decided to destroy the holocron, leaving the destiny of these Force-sensitive children to be decided by the Force. Well, hello again there, viewers. This is Brian, the Three Topics Gamer, here to present to you what will be my very last first series matchup that I'll be uploading for my channel. So I thought it was only proper that for my final matchup video, I would explore the very franchise that inspired me to start my own versus series years ago in Star Wars. Now, I have ventured into this franchise once before, and it actually ended up being one of my personal favorite matchups I ever put together. So for this matchup, I thought it would be awesome to pit these two interesting characters against each other, as Galen Marek, who I openly consider to be the last pre-Disney character I ever liked, will take on Cal Kestis, who is without question the best character that was created during the Disney era of Star Wars, to see which one of these two would win if they ever encountered each other. Now, when it comes to my sources of information for Galen Marek, while the majority of the visuals will be taken from the video game and comic book series, the majority of the primary information that I will be using to analyze Galen Marek will be taken from the novelization of Star Wars The Force Unleashed, as well as taking some information from a few key websites to go more in depth with Galen's capabilities as a combatant. And for Cal Kestis, I'll be taking my information based on what was presented in the Jedi Fallen Order video game, as well as a few websites to fill in some of the blanks that the game didn't cover. So before I begin, if you do happen to enjoy this final matchup of mine, please do not forget to like, share, and subscribe, and keep track of me on all my future projects as I have planned for my channel. So without wasting any more time, let's go into this final breakdown as we start analyzing these two physically. By the time of his death in 2BBY, Galen Marek was a 17-year-old human male standing 6'1", and for someone so young, he was still in great shape and was entering the early stages of his physical prime. Receiving extensive training from Darth Vader for a decade or more crafted Galen into a tough combatant physically, whose slim but muscular build allowed him to fight for extensive periods of time without slowing down. And this combined with his respectable levels of strength could allow Galen to keep up a constant wave of combative pressure on a target. Galen's strength was also developed high enough to support his defensive capabilities, so much so that he was actually able to hold off Darth Vader's powerful strength-focused attacks while he was in a state of rage. His years of training with Vader and the training droid proxy allowed Galen to develop a high tolerance of physical pain, which was elevated even more after being reconstructed after Vader stabbed Galen in the back and threw him into the vacuum of space. This reconstruction was so effective that it allowed Galen to be hit by a heavy stone table, only suffering a few cracked ribs and only needing a short period of time to fully recover. Galen was by no means invincible. He could be killed, but anything less than a decapitation, a pierce through the heart, or a powerful explosion of force energy is not going to be enough to keep this guy down and fighting back even harder. By the end of Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order, Cal Kestis was also a 17-year-old human male standing somewhere between 5'9 and 5'11 and had a very average slim build. Without the use of force augmentation, there wasn't anything specifically exceptional about Cal physically. He possessed average strength, speed, stamina, while respectfully being acrobatic, performing dodges and flips to avoid attacks. There may be something to be said about Cal's durability, as he has been on several times been thrown around by opponents and fallen from extreme heights and survived, and he has been stabbed by his own lightsaber by Darth Vader and managed to get up, suffering probably only minor injuries. In my personal opinion, when it comes to Cal and just how much punishment he can take, he is ranked only slightly above average, but this is simply due to his youth, and he still has a little ways to go before he reaches the standard physical feats that even average Jedi Knights would have been expected to be able to perform in combat. This run is extremely easy to call. One combatant is built to survive, while the other one is built for fighting. To Galen's advantage, his extensive amount of time in training under Vader had allowed Galen to fight on par and even outperform fully developed Jedi like Romcode and Shaak-Ti, and even contend with the cybernetic horror that is Darth Vader, who all have decades more of training and combat experience than Cal does. Now, to Cal's credit, he has proven that he can hold his own, and that he's not entirely helpless against opponents who have had better training and more combat experience, but his success against his opponents were held under circumstantial elements. Against the Knife Sister, he managed to outmaneuver and attack an exposed opening that she left. Against Taron Malakos, he needed help from Marin. And against Trilla, he had the opportunity to fight her on three different occasions, which more than certainly helped him get used to her fighting style before their final battle. Which means that in a physical sense, Cal is going to have to work extremely hard to stay in the fight, while the physically superior combatant in Galen is going to have a commanding advantage in the physical sense, and the longer that this battle goes on, if it does go for an extended period of time, Galen will be able to keep up fighting at a peak level, while Cal is going to start tiring out, and will be unquestionably start being overpowered if he's cornered. And because of these reasons, Galen Marek will get the edge in physical capabilities. Over the course of his career, Galen Marek would use two different lightsabers. The first one was built during his training under Darth Vader and would be lost in the vacuum of space. But his lightsaber that he will be using for this matchup was the lightsaber he took from Master Rom Koda. Now, this lightsaber was a heavy-duty model with a solid hilt and an emitter shroud. The hilt was covered with an interwoven fabric wrapping that acted as a grip for the weapon. When Galen received this weapon from Vader after his reconstruction, the blade was created with the use of a green crystal, and while Galen could easily use this weapon, he was uncomfortable realizing that this weapon still belonged to Rom Koda. This changed when Galen replaced Koda's green crystal with his father's blue crystal, which gave the lightsaber better handling and possessed superior optical properties. This completed the final customization of the lightsaber, symbolizing that the weapon was now completely Galen's, and he would continue to use this weapon until his death, where the weapon would be destroyed by Darth Vader. The lightsaber that Cal would use up until the end of Jedi Fallen Order originally belonged to his master, Jarrah T'Pol. The weapon was built originally as an extended double-bladed lightsaber that was designed with a syndicular hand grip and a squared emitter, which more than likely used two blue kyber crystals for its blades. The weapon would be damaged when Order 66 was issued, leaving only one of the emitters working. Cal would hang on to this damaged weapon for 5 years until he was forced to use it for the first time in combat. While exploring Dathomir, Cal would experience a vision which would cause the weapon to be damaged, making it unusable. Traveling to Ilum, now equipped with a broken remains of Jarrah's lightsaber and the lightsaber emitter which belonged to Seer, Cal would combine the two weapons into an extended lightsaber, which could not only switch between single blade and double blades, but Seer's emitter could actually detach and reattach, allowing Cal to wield two lightsabers at once. With this unique weapon, it granted Cal a completely new set of combative options without suffering the weakness of traditional double-bladed lightsabers. Though I do not have any proof of this, it is my belief that the combination of three kyber crystals, two from Jarrah's lightsaber and one from Seer's, that the center chamber remained empty, which meant that in the event that the center section would be cut, that Cal could still use this weapon as two separate lightsabers, just not being able to connect the two until he repaired the weapon. This run is pretty simple to call. Galen Marek's lightsaber was a well-built weapon, but compared to Cal's, it is painfully basic. Cal's weapon has not only gone through more customizations, but this has granted Cal more combative options and grants him more flexibility, especially when it comes to his style of lightsaber combat that he will be using, which I will discuss next. So for these reasons, Cal Kestis gets the edge in weapons and equipment. Being trained under Darth Vader allowed Galen to develop his skills in lightsaber combat in a very unique way that was uncommon when compared to the Imperial Inquisitors or even fully developed Sith across their entire Order's history. Vader took his own defeat by Obi-Wan Kenobi's hands very much to heart and decided that instead of training Galen to focus on his skills across a few traditional lightsaber forms, he used multiple sparring matches against himself and the training droid proxy to force Galen to develop elements from multiple different fighting forms, then create a personalized style of combat that allowed him to respond to multiple different combat conditions. Once this was done, Marek was then allowed to choose core disciplines that he believed allowed him to grant the highest probability of success in combat. He studied the traditional seven lightsaber forms in order to develop a better understanding of how each of them worked, but from what I can tell, the three primary forms that Galen seemed to favor were Form 3 Sarisu thanks to the Obi-Wan Kenobi avatar from Proxy, Form 5 Sheen / Jim So, as it was the preferred form of his master Darth Vader, and Form 7 Juyo, which some have deemed as a Sith style of combat, and since Galen was originally inspired to one day become a true Sith, Juyo does seem to be a form that he would gravitate towards. I find this build for Galen rather interesting to me because it gives him a three-stage fighting structure. One was for pure defense, one was for pure offense, and one does a mixture of both. Form 3 Sarisu was originally developed to counter the widespread of blaster technology, but over time it would be easily adapted for lightsaber combat. Sarisu provided maximum defensive protection in a way that was characterized as using tight, efficient movements to conserve stamina. Sarisu on a tactical level could be used as a fallback option should a combatant's offense be proven ineffective, or be used to allow a user time to strategize and wait for their opponent to leave an opening or make a critical mistake. Galen was shown to be highly proficient with his use of Sarisu, as shown as he was not only capable of defending himself against Ram Koda's highly offensive variation of Form 7 Juyo, but against Darth Vader's variation of Form 5 Jimso, and this was while Vader was in a state of rage. But I would like to state that Galen would not be able to sustain this quality of defense for an extended period of time as someone like, say, Obi-Wan Kenobi could. When it comes to Form 5 Sheehan, it was developed with the goal of using defensive maneuvers with immediate offensive counters. Unlike Sarisu, the Sheehan variation of Form 5 was designed for blaster deflection, firing shots back at the shooter, and Galen has openly favored the reverse grip of Sheehan that was known, and while Galen has had knowledge of the second variation of Form 5 Jimso, thanks to his master Darth Vader, I do not believe that he specialized in it. Form 7 Juyo was the most aggressive out of the seven primary lightsaber fighting forms and was dedicated to pure offense with absolutely no defense in an attempt to overwhelm an opponent. Though traditional applications of Juyo called upon a user to draw upon their own emotions, this is something that I do not believe Galen could have done due to the fact that the variation of Juyo that he learned from Proxy was nothing more than a technical imitation of the form devoid of any emotion, and because of that, Galen too only used this on a technical level. The interesting element about Juyo is that it requires a user to be highly skilled in multiple different forms in order to customize it into a unique variation of Juyo, and this perfectly fits with how Galen's early training under Vader developed him to do. However, while Galen could be seen as a master swordsman in his own right, and he has proven that he can compete with true master swordsmen like Ram Koda, Shakti, and Darth Vader, his skill level across the multiple fighting forms that he was trained under was not at all developed to a true master's level, and he would always have to eventually fall back on using his force abilities. While Galen has been shown to incorporate some force powers into his lightsaber sequences like a 9-man practitioner, it was very limited, and primarily Galen would keep his lightsaber maneuvers and force abilities separate, relying on probing offenses with his lightsaber while keeping his powers in reserve until he needed them. As a combatant, his greatest strength was his versatility, which kept him flexible and able to adapt to different combat scenarios and situations. But this in itself created its own weakness, because Galen has spread himself out so much that he can never truly master any element of his lightsaber skills to the highest level. And without his extremely powerful inverted use of the Force, he would stand no chance against dedicated lightsaber masters. Cal's early training under Master Jarrah T'Pol during the Clone Wars was very traditional, which gave Cal a strong foundation which could allow him to develop his lightsaber combat very quickly. While Jarrah's fighting style has never been confirmed, I believe that he was a practitioner in Form 6 Niman, shown with his lightsaber sequences, his specialized weapon, and the incorporation of force abilities within his lightsaber sequences along with showing elements of different fighting forms within his attacks. This is something that I believe he would have passed down to Cal, but because of the 5 years that Cal had stayed low preventing him from being found by the Empire, during the early moments of Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order, Cal's skills would have regressed to a basic level of Form 1 Sicho, shown by his defeat by the hands of Trilla, the second sister. Form 1 Sicho was the tutorial style and focused on direct and simple bladework and relied on wide open strikes to attack multiple opponents, as the form was designed to be used on the open battlefield. But because of its attack sequences, it left a user of Form 1 very vulnerable against opponents who could apply precision and had a strong foundation on blade-on-blade lightsaber combat, which is exactly how Form 2 Mikashi was developed. However, by the end of the game, Cal had gained a great amount of combat experience against a wide variety of different enemies, which included Imperial Forces, Wildlife, Empowered Knight Brothers and Resurrected Knight Sisters, and other Force wielders, along with having his connection to the Force being restored and even grown a bit stronger. And his use of a specialized lightsaber would have made Cal a well-rounded user of Form 6 Niman. Form 6 Niman, also known as the Moderation Form or the Way of the Rancor, was the most hybridized fighting form by incorporating elements of the preceding four forms. It wasn't as precise as Form 2, not as defensive as Form 3, not as kinetic as Form 4, or as dominating as Form 5. Niman was originally developed not to focus on using any singular method of combat, but to allow its users to have multiple combative options at their disposal to allow them to adapt to just about any combat situation they found themselves up against, making the transition between using multiple different elements from different fighting forms much smoother. Due to this, Nemon did not possess any combative strengths, but it also didn't possess any critical weaknesses. And Cal would use the precision strikes and disarming binds of Forms 2, the defensive deflections and blaster bolts from Form 3, the acrobatics and use of physical strikes from Form 4, and the blaster redirection of blaster bolts back at the shooter and parrying attacks of both variations of Form 5. To compensate for Neiman's much more relaxed take on blade work, the form encouraged a user to integrate force powers into their attack sequences. Most specifically, the draw closer and pushing slash techniques, along with using the specialized ability known as force stasis into his maneuvers, which I will discuss later on in the video. Unlike someone like XR Kun, who modified his variation of Nemon to be more offensively dominating with his use of his specialized weapon, Cal used a much more traditional take on the form, more in line with how his master Jaro used it, but with an additional set of extra elements. Because of his extra functions of Cal's lightsaber being able to split apart, this allowed Cal the ability to perform Jar Kai, and both Form 4 Ataru and especially Form 6 Nemon specialize in having elements that incorporate the use of dual-wielding lightsabers. The use of two lightsabers in combat provided a user with improved offensive and defensive coverage, along with having a higher rate of attacking and having a greater ability to contend with multiple opponents. However, interestingly enough, I believe that Cal's use of Jirkai adopted a mix of Ataru and Nemon's mentalities. Instead of relying on a dedicated practice of the form, he kept it in reserve and would only use his Jirkai attacks in short controlled bursts in order to prevent himself from becoming too predictable or exhausting himself. His use of Jirkai could also be seen while using his weapon as a double-bladed lightsaber, as this improved his awareness of both blades and used his combination more effectively, but it does seem that while using both blades, he would focus on more speed instead of power to overwhelm his opponent's defenses. However, Nemon's focus on moderation made Cal very weak against users who could execute a true master-level application of a lightsaber form that was dedicated to lightsaber combat, specifically Form 2 Mikashi and Form 5 Jemso. Despite this, I think that Cal Kestis should be commended for his ability to develop an effective quality of Nemon so quickly and at such a young age. He would be a solid challenge to all but the absolute top tier masters, and for anyone below that level, underestimating Cal Kestis would be a serious mistake. From the outside, Galen Marek and Cal Kestis share a lot of similarities. Both combatants have constructed their own unique fighting styles to take elements from multiple different fighting forms and allow them to adapt to a multitude of different combat scenarios, and they both have been so successful at this that it has allowed them to contend with opponents that had more training and more experience than they did, taking advantage that each of their opponents has relied on a more narrow and focused fighting approach. But it's when you start looking at the weaknesses of these two that you come to realize that when it comes to pure lightsaber combat, only one combatant has the flexibility to exploit the other's weaknesses, and that combatant is Cal Kestis. Galen has built his skills to be able to cover all of his bases. Sarisu gives him a strong defense, Shien gives him a balanced offense, and Jiyu gives him a focused offense to overwhelm his opponents. The problem for Galen is that he has not elevated any of these forms to a true master's level. And because of that, he is not going to be able to defeat Cal Kestis purely based on lightsaber combat. And this is consistent when it comes to Galen, as the vast majority of his victories against opposing force wielders has come with Galen overwhelming them with the force and not through true lightsaber combat. And the reason why Galen's force powers cannot be included in this department, but they can for Cal's, is because Galen keeps his lightsaber skills and force abilities mainly separate, while Cal is always incorporating the two sides together, as it is a core element of the Nemon form. And when you take into account that due to Galen's training with Proxy, Proxy's imitation of all seven lightsaber forms gave Galen an idea of what he could expect. But when it comes to Nemon specifically and how it incorporates the Force so much in a way that the other forms don't, it means that because Proxy cannot use the Force, there is a unique element that Galen would not be aware of, and this is something that could possibly catch him off guard. When it comes to pure lightsaber combat, Galen's Sarisu would allow him to defend himself against Cal, but since Cal doesn't have an aggressive state of mind, he's not going to be able to tire him out. His use of Shien would simply allow Galen to deliver a solid amount of offense against Cal, but he won't be able to overwhelm him. And when he decides to crank up the offense and switch to Jiyu, he's going to leave himself openly exposed to Nemon's inclusion of force powers, as Jiyu's total focus on offense will leave Galen completely open defensively. Now, while Galen also used some elements of the Nemon form when it comes to using force abilities along with his lightsaber, I do not believe that he specialized in this, and his use of such attacks would have been very limited, and not taken to the same level as Cal's. This is made even worse when you take Cal's specialized lightsaber to account. What this would allow Cal to do is put some serious pressure on Galen's defenses, and when Galen tries to respond with his Sheen, I believe that Cal will still be able to outmatch Galen's offense with his own. And when Galen switches to Juyo, Cal is going to have a couple of force abilities ready to off-balance Galen once again. Now, some might say that because of his success against better quality combatants like Rom Koda, Shaak Ti, and Darth Vader, should obviously give Galen the advantage, but none of them had the equipment nor have built their lightsaber skill sets like Cal. I am in no way suggesting that Cal Kestis is as good of a lightsaber duelist as combatants like Shaak Ti or Darth Vader specifically. Those two have built up their skill sets and the proper forms into the proper level it would take to contend with everything Cal Kestis could bring to the table, whether it would be single blade, double blade, or dual blade lightsaber combat. And while Galen was able to adapt to all of them to certain degrees, his success against them was once again based upon his use of the Force, not lightsaber combat. Cal's own experience against the likes of the Inquisitors and the fallen Jedi Taron Malakos will have him better prepared for just about everything Galen is going to bring to this fight when it comes to pure lightsaber combat alone. A strong defense that can't be easily overwhelmed, a solid offense that can be responded to, and a powerful offense that becomes too narrow that it leaves the user open to unconventional attacks and with the use of the Force. And like Cal, all of them are using unique weapon sets that were far better than Galen's standard lightsaber, meaning that Galen's application of his fighting forms, which is much similar, will be something that Cal has already faced before. And because of this, I feel comfortable giving Cal Kestis the edge in lightsaber skills and abilities. Even at a young age, Galen showed a powerful connection to the Force, which is one of the key factors that led to Vader deciding to train Galen as his secret apprentice. And by the time of his death, there is no question that Galen Marek had become one of the most combatively effective Force wielders the galaxy had ever known. While I certainly wouldn't put him on the same level as true top-tier masters of the Force like Grandmasters Luke Skywalker and Yoda, or even dark side wielders like Darth Sidious and Darth Revan, Galen could be seen as a solid threat to top-tier masters like them, not to be underestimated. However, Galen's effectiveness with the Force to me was not so much determined by his magnitude of strength, but how Galen had fine-tuned his skills with the Force to such a degree that he could dish out his Force attacks faster than most opposing Force wielders would be able to respond to. He has experienced serious difficulty when forced to contend directly with the powers of other Force wielders. He can't penetrate the telekinetic barriers of even low-tier combatants, while his own Force barriers have been consistently broken. To get around this, Galen had to get creative with his collection of Force powers and chain them together to distract, off-balance, and work around an opponent's defenses, and he has developed so many different Force attacks that it has given him plenty of options. Being trained in the ways of the dark side gave Galen access to abilities like telekinesis, Force lightning, mind tricks, physical augmentation, Force deflection, and tutaminus. Tutaminus in particular was the ability that he used to contain Darth Sidious' Force Lightning to give his allies time to escape, and while he could contain the power for a short period of time, he could not stop the amount of building power from harming him, which led directly to his death. His use of telekinesis powers like Force Push, Force Pull, and Force Repulse were highly effective against non-Force wielding groups of enemies, but when it came to how effective these abilities were against opposing Force wielders, Galen had to again get creative with his application of these powers, either by wearing his opponents down first, using environmental hazards, or chaining different powers together at a faster rate than his opponents could respond to. One element of Galen's application of the Force that I personally believe he could do was his ability to amplify his Force output when either put under enough pressure or given enough time to concentrate. This ability was known as Force Rage or Force Fury, and both Galen Marek and his Starkiller clone have both been credited with knowing this ability, yet they used it in slightly different ways. One major example of this was his telekinetic feat with the Star Destroyer on Raxus Prime. Many believe that Galen Marek pulled the Star Destroyer completely down, as the video game would have you believe, but in my opinion, based off what I got from the novel, what really happened was that Galen Marek took the Star Destroyer that was already coming down directly towards him and forced it into a nosedive and slowed down its momentum as best he could before he needed to get out of the way. Another example of this was during his fight against Shaak Ti. After knocking her back into the tentacles of the Sarlacc, he used, in my belief, an amplified application of Force Lightning to shock not only Shaak Ti, but the entire Sarlacc, which is something I believe his basic level of Force Lightning would not be able to do. Because of this, I believe that Galen has two levels of Force output, a basic standard level and an elevated amplified level, with the latter being capable if Galen is given enough time to concentrate or is put under enough pressure. When Galen recognized himself as a Jedi, he gained the ability of Foresight and was able to obtain oneness with the Force when facing Darth Sidious. Overall, Galen has an immense amount of Force potential that he could tap into under certain conditions, but while on the basic level he wasn't as powerful enough to match direct strength of true masters of the Force when they were at the top of their game, it was Galen's speed and creativity with his collection of Force powers that made him so dangerous against such opponents. Cal Kestis, by the time of Order 66, was a basic level Force wielder on a Padawan level. The trauma caused by the death of his master would seriously damage Cal's connection to the Force to the point that during the 5 years that he stayed in hiding, the only powers he retained were physical Force augmentation and the unique ability known as Force Stasis. By the time the Jedi Holocron was destroyed, Cal had successfully restored his connection to the Force to the same level it was when he was a Padawan, while developing some of his skills by a small amount. He could perform such telekinetic techniques such as Force Push, Force Pull, and Force Repulse to great effect against not only groups of enemies, but to off-balance large beasts. He could use Force Push to knock back opponents, Force Pull to grab Vimes to swing, or to perform the key Nyman attack draw closer, which could pull enemies towards him before he would impale them with his lightsaber. He could use Force Repulse to off-balance enemies, leaving them open to follow-up lightsaber strikes. He could also use the rare non-combative Force ability known as Force Echo, which would allow Cal to see visions of the history of a specific object. But Cal's most unique ability was his use of Force Stasis. This ability allowed Cal to forcibly restrain and immobilize people or objects, manifesting as a shimmering transparent energy field, canceling out the motion of a target for a period of time, leaving them exposed to a follow-up attack. Similar to how Inquisitor Jarek used Force Destruction to immobilize Jedi Master Qui-Ron before striking him with the killing blow. Though Cal had a respectable amount of different abilities, his overall strength in the Force was fairly basic, and in some departments was seriously underdeveloped, specifically his Force barriers, which were so weak that Cal could easily be knocked back by simple Force pushes or pulled towards enemies with Force pull, or even be immobilized by Force grip, preventing him from moving. Because of Cal's use, he was not exceptionally powerful with any of his abilities outside of Force Stasis, and instead seemed to rely on the Obi-Wan Kenobi tactic of using smaller and simpler applications of the Force to off-balance opponents. With the combination of his Nemon lightsaber form, he would attempt to wear opponents down over time. Cal was reasonably strong with the Force, but since he only managed to fully restore his connection to the Force shortly before his final engagement with the second sister Trilla, I do not believe that he grew a great amount from the time of Order 66 was issued to the time that he was knighted, and I believe that had the purge not happened and he was still allowed to develop under his original master, by the age of 17 he would still be a Padawan in development years before being elevated to the rank of Jedi Knight. The reason I saved Force abilities for last is because I believe that it is the one department that will ultimately decide who is going to win this fight. On a basic combative level, both Galen Marek and Cal Kestis share a number of Force abilities. Both can perform Force Push, Force Pull, and Force Repulse to somewhat similar effective levels, with the only powers exclusive to each other are Force Lightning in Galen's corner and Force Stasis in Cal's. While I personally believe that between these two abilities, Force Stasis is the superior, as Galen's Force Lightning can still be absorbed by a lightsaber, and Cal's use of Nemon means that he will always have his defenses ready to go should Galen attempt to use Force Lightning against him, Where things are going to go horribly wrong for Cal is that he is not going to be able to continue to go head-to-head with Galen's force abilities as the fight draws out. Galen's physical advantage will allow him to stay in the fight despite Cal having the advantage of a slightly more flexible lightsaber skill set with the use of his Nemon and specialized lightsaber. Galen's physicality and his own skills with the lightsaber will allow him to stay in the fight even if he starts making mistakes. And as the fight drags out and Galen realizes that he's not getting anywhere with his lightsaber, he will be pushed more and more to rely on chaining multiple force attacks faster than Cal can respond. The reason I believe this fight is much closer than some would like to believe is because Cal Kestis absolutely has everything he would need combatively to take out Galen Marek in the early stages of the fight. If Cal had a more offensively aggressive state of mind, since Galen would more than likely be opening up his Sarisu defense, he would allow Cal to make the first move. He could simply hit Galen with Force Stasis, which is an ability that he's never encountered before, then equipping both of his lightsabers could simply cut down and immobilize Galen Marek, ending the fight really quickly. But since Cal does not fight like this, he would allow the fight to play out in a more traditional sense. So the deciding question for this fight is this. Could Cal Kestis defeat Galen Marek before he start relying purely on his Force abilities? The short answer is no. Cal's experience against fallen Jedi Taran Malakos and the Inquisitors would allow him to deal with everything Galen is bringing with his lightsaber skills, but Galen's own experience against fully developed Jedi Masters means that he would be able to stay in the fight long enough to draw it out. Cal may be bringing a more flexible application of combat between his use of his lightsaber skills and Force abilities, but his quality of combat does not match the same level as proven Jedi Masters that Galen has already defeated. As the fight draws out and Galen realizes that he's not getting anywhere with his lightsaber skills, he would start relying more on his Force abilities. And if Galen gets to the point where he is pushed enough or even given enough time by Cal to concentrate and use his Force abilities on the amplified level, there is absolutely nothing Cal could do to resist, and he would be completely overwhelmed with the rate in which Galen would be firing off multiple different Force attacks on a level that he has never experienced. And because of this, Galen Marek gets the edge in Force abilities. When it comes to comparing Galen Marek to Cal Kestis, what you have is two individuals around the same age who really have taken the lessons that they've been taught and integrated them into every aspect of their combative capabilities. Cal has adopted the Nemon mentality of moderation and applied it to everything that he does in combat. The fact that he has had so much experience and success at such an early age is something that he should be commended for, and I can't wait to see how much he will improve when the sequel to his story is finally revealed. But Galen has taken the path of using the greatest strength that any Force wielder can have and applies it with a level of effectiveness that even the greatest masters between the light and dark side of the Force would not be able to contend with easily, that being relying on the greatest weapon any Jedi or Sith can master, and that is their use of the Force. And that is what will ultimately allow Galen Marek to walk away with the win. Let's say that this fight takes place on Bergano. Cal has just returned from Dathomir with the Astrium, and the Second Sister knows this and contacts Darth Vader and requests to go to Bergano, but he orders that she stand down and he will send someone else to recover the holocron. Back on Bergano, while Seer, Greez, and Marin wait on the Mantis, they suddenly see a ship in the distance land close to the vault. As Cal recovers the holocron, BD-1 is standing right next to him when he suddenly starts to sense that he's in danger. He immediately jumps to the side as a blast of Force lightning nearly hits him, but instead hits BD-1, immobilizing him. Cal turns to see who it is, and instead of Trill as he was expecting, it's Galen Marek who is standing there. Galen orders that Cal give him the holocron, but Cal simply puts it away and ignites his lightsaber, and Galen responds by doing the same, and their fight begins. Galen enters into a defensive stance and allows Cal to make the first move. Cal begins attacking Galen with a series of strikes, but they are easily defended against. Galen begins to believe that Cal hasn't been doing this for very long, and after a period of time switches over to his Sheen and begins counterattacking with his own offense. This causes Cal to become a bit more cautious as he can tell that Galen is a skilled combatant. Galen's own offense is matched by Cal's offense, so in an attempt to break the stalemate, Cal activates the second blade of his lightsaber, relying more on speed rather than strength, while throwing in a number of Jarkai double-bladed lightsaber strikes, and this allows Cal to start overwhelming Galen's own offense. Wanting to keep up this momentum, while using his double-bladed attacks, Cal starts relying on his Nemon tactics of integrating force pushes into his sequences, and this succeeds in knocking Galen back. Galen immediately responds by using his own force push to knock Cal back. At this point, Galen and Cal are exchanging force attacks. Cal attempts to use force pull to impale Galen, but before Galen is struck, he counters with force push, knocking Cal back. Cal responds with using force repulse to unbalance Galen. Galen responds with his own force repulse, knocking Cal back again. He follows this up with some force lightning, but Cal blocks it with his lightsaber. The two continue to exchange force attacks, but because Galen's superior physicality, Cal is getting the worst of it, and without BD-1 to give him a stem canister, he is starting to get worn down, but up to this point he has not yet used his secret attack force stasis yet. Sensing that Cal is starting to weaken, Galen returns to his lightsaber and now using Form 7 Jyo goes on the all-total offense. Back on the Mantis, Shear begins to sense that something might be wrong with Cal and leaves the ship and tells Grease and Marin to sit tight. Back in the vault, Cal is beginning to experience serious trouble, having difficulty defending against Galen's powerful offensive strikes of Jyo. Feeling that it is now time to use his secret weapon, he fires out a quick force repulse to the ground, which causes Galen to jump back a good distance, and as he charges towards Cal, he immediately is hit with force stasis, which freezes him in place. Galen cannot move, and sensing that he is in serious trouble and that Cal is beginning to approach him to finish him off, Galen draws on the full power of the dark side and breaks out of the force stasis with a powerful force repulse, knocking Cal back. Galen immediately follows up with a series of force pushes and force lightning to overwhelm Cal. Cal quickly realizes that he has no chance defeating Galen while he's in this empowered state. Seeing no other option, Cal, now injured, pulls out the holocron and destroys it so that Galen cannot recover the list. This enrages Galen as he lifts Cal and slams him on the ground and pins him down to finish him off. He suddenly feels a powerful force of power bringing him down to his knees, which causes him to lose his grip on Cal. Cal doesn't know what's happening, but as he looks behind Galen, he sees Shear behind him using her strength in the force to hold Galen down. She immediately tells Cal to run, and not wanting to argue, he runs past Galen, picking up an immobilized BD-1, and he tells Shear that he had to destroy the holocron, but Shear tells Cal not to worry about it and to get to the Mantis. Galen begins to fight back, returning to his feet, and using one final powerful force repulse, destroys sections of the vault. As Galen climbs out of the rubble, he can see the Mantis fly off, as Cal and Shear have escaped. Galen returns to his ship and informs Vader that though he was successful in defeating the Jedi, the holocron was destroyed and another Jedi appeared and that they have escaped. Vader says that he will send an Inquisitor to go after them, but he is to return to him for his next assignment. And with that, I declare Galen Marek, the Secret Apprentice, the winner. And that'll about do it for my Season 6 finale of my Versus series, as well as my very last matchup that I'll be doing for my channel. Now, I just want to point this out right now, that from the very beginning, I probably anticipated that Galen Marek would probably end up being the winner, but that wasn't really my goal. My goal for this matchup was really just to present the idea that Galen Marek was not as OP as the game was presented to be, as well as showing that Cal Kestis is not as weak as some people would like to believe. Between these two, there actually would be a legitimate contest, and while I'm sure that Galen would probably win 8 out of 10 times, I did want to present that Cal Kestis absolutely, at this current moment, has all of the necessary elements that would allow him to contend and in some cases perhaps even beat Galen Marek on a much smaller scale. And that was really my overall objective of this entire matchup. So I just hope that I've done that up to this point. But I would like to know, now that you guys have heard my thoughts on this matchup, I would just love to hear your guys' thoughts on this matchup. And do you agree that, yeah, Cal Kestis certainly could put up a challenge? Or do you still think that Galen Marek would just mop the floor with him without
question. Share your thoughts with me and everyone else in the comments down below. And before I go, I just want to thank all of you guys for your continued support. I've had a lot of fun and a lot of challenges doing the reverse series over the last, I'd say, 5, 6, maybe almost 7 years, which, just think, that is a long time. I've done almost over, probably over 60 matchups, and I gotta say, I have had a chance to talk to a lot of you out there and gotten your points on certain matchups. And again, I just want to thank all of you guys for your continued support. Even though I won't be doing any more Verse Series matchups, do not think for a second that I will not be responding to older matchups. If you do happen to comment on those, my analytical mind will always be running. And I still have a lot of great content outside of the Verse Series that I do plan to upload for my channel moving forward, especially since I'll be going back into filming for the month of October. So I hope you guys will continue to stay with me. So, like always, I want to thank all of you guys for watching. Thank you. I hope you guys have enjoyed my Verse Series and will enjoy more content that I will be uploading in the near future. And remember, you guys are awesome, and I will catch you all next time.